can take that $15,000 and spread it out quarterly.
Spread it out over here.
I mean, it has to be paid by whatever date.
But they're probably like us, and if they're rich when taxes come in, when registrations are fresh, that's when they have money. Quarterly doesn't make a whole lot of sense, because they don't have a lot of money involved, they don't have a lot of money.
If you read the last paperwork from back in March, that was said in there, and they agreed to that, and then just didn't pay. Said, we broke it down, Bob did, he broke it down.
They use the bills, but I have to pay.
So we went that route, and all they do is ignore it. Doesn't go to the point, it was like, okay, then just.
Take a look as the athletic committee, see if there's anything we can wiggle with in our 15. Bring it back to this council, we'll take a look at it and make a decision then.
No, you're good, yeah, I'm gonna be next week, so.
Yeah, this isn't something that they're gonna.
I don't think it's gonna happen before our November meeting.
It's not, well, they want this decision by December 20th, and considering they've waited all this time, they're gonna wait until we get ready to come back with whatever we have. We're in the middle of our budget stuff too, and the holidays, so for us to have to throw this together and put this out there. If we make it, we make it, if we don't, they're gonna wait for us at this point to get that together. They have all year to come and it's not like they have not contacted them.
To put an end to this wobbling.
That's fine.
So we will remove that from the agenda. Just remove, probably in December. And then the MR Writer settlement is our new 8B.
When do we do that?
November 28th, I believe it is.
Yeah, 28th.
Excuse me.
And what's that going to read? The motion.
Do we have to do a motion for something?
No, there's nothing we have to do.
So just paying the bills.
Something's gonna happen, so.
Do it, was it on there, is it not on there?
They'll announce that at the meeting.
Who will announce it?
Our solicitor.
Okay.
Who did the easement line.
Something we have to vote on or not? Would that be part of the solicitor report?
So that would be a.
Could have been under announcements, but that's what Dave says.
Yeah, why wasn't it in the presentation?
It hasn't happened yet, we can move on.
It's a surprise.
He can just give that to us as part of the solicitor's report. I don't think it needs to be separate.
Yeah, why would it be financed then? Take it out finance?
It will be financed at some point, but this is just information, I believe. There's no action for us to take, it can come in his report.
Okay, so you're moving that, and he's gonna do it under his report?
Yeah.
Does he know that it's financed?
All right, so under solicitor's report, do market MR Writer?
MR Writer report, solicitor.
Under the solicitor, and take it off of this?
Yep, so just 8A, under finance. 9A is a motion to authorize the borough manager to advertise hiring a full-time code enforcement officer, which was tabled at the last meeting and must be brought back at this meeting.
Hold on one second.
What happens if we don't bring it off the table?
What?
Have you voted on it, but it doesn't die?
I think that's a question for Dave Sanders.
If you don't bring it off the table, does it expire, you just didn't bring it off the table?
Yeah, sorry, actually, I didn't touch much of this.
You don't vote on it?
Well.
We're touching anything he's touched.
I'm under antibiotics, so I'm good.
And then under new business, there is 10A, a circuit trail resolution, which we got. And I would like to add 10B, a motion to name the Levy Top Trail the Capitol View River Walk. If we're focused on trails, that might be one we wanna add to our repertoire.
So, Brad, and that 10B will be?
A motion to name the Levy Top Trail the Capitol View River Walk.
Hold on a second, what was that?
Motion, right, it's.
Separate resolution.
Yeah, just a motion to get it officialized.
What was that?
What's it called?
The Capitol View River Walk. Right now, it has no name, and it hasn't for the 80 years that it's existed. But it's a pretty nice walk, as the workers of Trent will tell you. And if we get signage someday, it'd be nice to point to it and say, hey, that's the Capitol.
The levy itself.
Yeah, the levy, the trail at the top of the levy.
And that's called the name of Brandon, that's.
It has no name.
It doesn't have a name.
But I'd like, that's.
Levy.
It's called the levy.
This is called the levy walk, right?
But you want, they want to change, they want to actually give it a name.
I would like to give it a name.
They're paying for the levy, so Fred wants.
Capital View Riverwalk. If you walk on, you have a view of the Capitol.
I think the Capitol View is firehouse.
Right, which is named that for the same reason. If you're on top of the Capitol View Firehouse, you can see the Capitol now. You could drive down Maple someday.
You received the email from,
Sounds better.
Representative Warren.
Yeah.
About the HB 271 gaming bill.
Yes.
Did you want?
I asked Bob what was going on with that, if he was preparing anything, and he said something was in the works.
No, well, he's, for us not to do anything is saying we would be interested in having some type of small game chance. The only way we can end up having a, like a small casino is if Parks Casino would want a mini casino, like with slot machines and all that, here in Morrisville Borough. But that's totally up to them. So the bill that just passed the House is a bill that are going to expand the amount of casinos in Pennsylvania.
Amount?
Yes, and then they put this.
With a 25-mile radius of an existing casino.
Yes, can't be within 25.
So we would not be covered by that because we've got a casino within 25 miles of us.
However, if Parks Casino.
They can waive that. Parks Casino can waive that.
For themselves.
And they can put a mini casino. I got a perfect spot for it.
Your backyard house.
That room.
Machines already ready to go.
All right, so don't worry about that then?
No, we're doing that.
And that's all we have for this month's agenda. Does anyone else would like to add something?
Well, I'd want to revisit this.
Okay.
Mrs. Smith gave me a company that does code enforcement, I mean, yeah, UCC, UNOs, soup to nuts. Like, we're going to use them instead of having a code enforcement officer.
Other than the company.
So I called them up and they explained to me, you know, how it would work and all. And I said to them before I got off the phone, I says, could you give me a community that you would believe that is closest you could get to Morrisville Borough? So he did that and I called their borough manager up and he was more than happy to help me. And I did a cost comparison from Morrisville Borough compared to Mwakwa.
Mwakwa Borough.
Yeah, so you can hear the cost comparison compared to. And also, I would like to send you a 2 pages of the budget that Doylestown Borough has, and then also some budget from Bristol Borough and what they pay in code enforcement and what they receive and how many code enforcement officers they have. It's all the budget.
Do you have the what our code enforcement brings in?
Yeah, it's all that sheet.
Okay.
This is just information you can take. Again, this didn't come to the decision to keep a code enforcement officer because I would love to have one because it would be easier for me.
Oh, I thought you were going to get some more down.
Yeah, he's just the one who came out. I'd like to.
Oh.
Yeah, these all keep having them, yeah.
Oh, they're all going to get
down. Yeah. I guess you can start sending them to Karen. Don't keep one. Vic, keep one, and I'll pass you or two.
Okay, keep one. No. Oh, keep it to Vic.
Yep, just send them all around. Here come your orders.
Can I keep one?
Yeah, you can get one.
Just give you an idea.
No, I'm good.
Well, I'm confused as hell.
I only had four.
You only had four. You only had one. I don't know.
Bob was doling them out very slowly, so I had four.
We're all getting sick.
No, you're not. Hey, listen.
So this is someone else's budget?
This is Doyle's deal.
And here's.
Well, that's not even apples and oranges.
I know, but I've given you an idea of what the costs are from two different boroughs around here. Now, this is, here, fix this law, this is Bristol Borough. What they, how many, it shows you how many code enforcement officers they have and how much they spend per year on it.
I think we've got enough.
I'm sorry, yes.
Take more pieces.
Okay, thank you.
And also, you'll find in that one, the comparison, the issue that we have out of everything that we're looking at moving forward is that, like this Tumwaqua, they pay their code enforcement company out of their general fund. And one of the reasons they can do that is because they have an $8 million budget. Water and sewer is a part of the general fund budget.
I did a management study of Tumwaqua several years back. One of our former councilmen. Tumwaqua has an apartment house that they own. 1,800 residents in it. And they concession it out. They also have a reservoir there that pays for two police officers. They're essentially the same size. It's a famous place. It's where the coal miner rebuilt. As a matter of fact, Black Jack has a tombstone there that everybody visits. Famous point of Pennsylvania, you should. Anywho, Tumwaqua has certain differences demographically than we have.
Yeah.
They do have migrant people that live there because they've worked on the various farms. They're not near a big city.
Truly.
Their police department is efficient, I guess as most police departments go. But their finances are essentially in good shape. And I think mainly because they have facilities that we don't have. They own it. They own this. I forget how high it is.
That is really
it's 18
scary.
Stories.
18 stories. It's a big building. I don't know. Somebody left them that years. I did the study 20 years ago, and they had it for years.
I mean, they own it.
They own it. The borough owns it.
The borough owns it.
And they have a management company that runs it.
So the landlords.
And they collect the rents.
That's a whole different ballgame.
Yeah, that's.
I don't think it pays their whole general fund.
No, but it's still a revenue stream that most.
But it's a revenue stream.
But there, that's all here, what they bring in from taxes compared to what we bring in from taxes.
What do they bring in?
Twice, bring in 1.4 million. Yes. This is well based on 2016 numbers, but on our behalf, on this list that doesn't show, is that we will have $45,600 in residential applications once we, if we move forward with, with the Act 90, which we voted on already. Plus, we will. Also be receiving a 60-40 split with UCC. We will have to make sure, because most of everything that we have under code enforcement is property maintenance. The code enforcement covers UCC and all that. It's we've already third-party the UCC work.
Can I clarify something for a second?
Yes.
You explained it to me, We only pay out to them. The company we're using right now is because they adopted our fee schedule. They only do partial things.
No, we had to adopt their fee schedule.
Theirs, which is where that.
And we will.
Right, which is the higher amount would be. That's where the 46.
So when they do electrical, plumbing, construction, permit fees, we would receive a 40% of their take, which is not shown on this cost comparison.
Offsets the cost
for
if you need to use them for some of the other things.
Now, this gentleman who I called from the borough of Tumwaqua, he told me, Mr. Subi, you got to remember one thing. Code enforcement is like your police department. You don't expect to make money on it. Well, that's good when you have a water and sewer budget and also apartment building.
Yeah. Fee for service money is what it is.
Yeah.
We can't ever charge for a fee for service.
And, yeah, so last year, they brought in $120,000. They put out $120,000. In return from their agreement with the third party, they received $80,000. Now, that's not just UCC, that includes UNOs as well. And the guy, they have two gentlemen that work for them. And he said to me that, you know, we got an 18-story building, they were mostly in that building all the time because it was like, I think.
You have a turnover there.
Yeah.
Oh, so, yeah.
So it's just something I gave you for a little bit more information. If you go to the next page on that, what I gave you, it shows where we get our code enforcement salaries from. So we can't just afford to pay a third party out of our general fund. Because the way we do it is now, and then we do have a higher cost now, being that the current code enforcement officer's been here for so many years. So the third is with the code enforcement clerical, how that, where that funds come from. So again, if we would go with a third party, most likely, unless we can do something with our budget, using a third party, we couldn't afford to pay them for it out of our general fund, the way it is now.
It's 40%.
That doesn't make any sense. I mean, the budget is broken down through the budget. So the salaries, correct? I mean, it does not come out of the general. It comes out of all three parts of the budget.
Yeah. Yeah.
But either way, it's paid for. There's a line item that pays a certain amount for that.
For what?
That doesn't make any sense.
You're talking about the code enforcement officer salary?
Yeah, so no matter where you pull this, still pull that budget the same amount.
From the different funds.
Right.
And we set that office up.
That's what I'm saying.
So it's already paid. We didn't pay, save everything out of the general fund, because we couldn't.
So what we do now with our third party, we pay out of the general fund.
You have third party, what?
You're getting the 40-60.
Because they have no other function other than code enforcement or inspections.
So just to know that Tawakwa was also in a 60-40 split, so that's what their totals were.
And they lost $40,000.
And their closest city to them is Allistown, which is 30 miles away. We have a city right next to us. And we know what track covered over here to pass on their blight. We want to build up our community through code enforcement to, you know, give the residents of Morrisville the hope that in the future, Morrisville is being proactive. Fighting blight. That's one of the things we did with that diagram.
So the breakout cost for this year, the in-house cost, you've given us that number. Before you said it was 270, now it's down to 200,955. We've never gotten the breakout cost.
Well,
we've asked you for that.
What the breakout cost for what, Debbie?
Yeah, how you came up. Where's your backup? You've never gotten any of that. And obviously it's down how much. And it also doesn't include, we also don't do any.
Look, Debbie, I'm just giving you information because I'm telling you, bring a third party in. I'll be happy.
All I'm saying is.
I'm doing also, what I'm doing, save the borough.
If we're looking at the numbers, you also don't have in there what's going to be charged for the rental property maintenance fees. And we haven't implemented that.
Well, that will be in the new budget.
On how many rentals you have and what you have, right. But that's also part of the money that we're committing.
Yeah, but this is based off of 2016. I mean, I was going to add a line for that, but I didn't want to confuse me. Because this is based off of 2016.
I think you were thinking $25.
$25 a piece.
It's
not going to
be a lot.
Yeah, well, $45 an inspection? Yeah.
Yeah.
What about a re-inspection if there are violations?
Well, we will have additional fees that we'll be able to bring in.
The $25 was to register your rental, and then there was a different fee for the inspection.
Right.
Well, we have that fee now.
That's what I mean. Right. So the inspection.
So you're going to be getting an extra $25.
Well, we're sending out to all the residents because it's the only way we can get the information that we need. because there's a lot of apartments that we don't know are apartments, which that will end up being penalties, excuse me, finding apartments they don't register.
They're gonna stay that way.
So, we have.
Our assumptions are that we're close to 50% rentals, is that right?
Yeah, 45,200, we'll bring you just all the application, registration. Where you park it.
That's not including the inspection.
That's just, so that's the tool that we start from.
We still have to get to that point to collect the $25, we still don't know who you can send that out to. And that's all in-house stuff that this company or any other company is gonna charge for.
Yep.
That we will get nothing back from. To outsource this, I just, I'm not seeing how this is financially responsible in any way, shape, or form. And I don't know how we could be possibly proactive with a third party.
You've never tried it in 30 years, so once you get all these numbers, how do you know that?
How, but to get to those numbers is going to be hours and hours and weeks of in-house administrative work that we will get nothing back from.
The company, but you have the company do it, you have somebody in-house doing it, you have to gather all that information there.
Correct, but if you have an in-house person, they could also be doing other things. It wouldn't just be their full-time, this isn't their full-time job, they would also be here to answer questions from residents, they would also be here to give citations, if they're driving around.
In Bristol boroughs.
And how would you go about looking for the rooms that are losing the apartments? You'd have to go up on the county site, right, to the properties, and look at the idea of it.
Well, I think.
See if you're resident or not.
There are houses that have been broken into apartments that should not have been, and you're not gonna find that in county. You're gonna have to.
If you look, Bristol Borough has a code enforcement and property administration person, and pays $63,630. They also have a code enforcement officer that makes $85,546. And then they have assistant code enforcement officer, and they charge, that's $24,000.
How much is benefits?
Plus they have an outside company?
Just on the use, no.
That's Bristol Township, I believe.
This is Bristol Borough.
Well, they do use a third party as well, but.
And what is their owner occupied ratio? Do you not?
I don't think we have that.
They're close to us though, they are almost 50% from what Jim told me.
Bristol Borough?
Yeah. I think they're actually more rentals than ours.
They have it by year, at least a year then.
It could be.
And like I said, I just gave you this information so you can, you know, think about it, you know, realize that, you know, I wouldn't mind to have a third party, I'm just worried about as budgetarial.
For 2017 was $70,000, was the registration, just the registration.
Well, since we're just getting handed this tonight, I'd like to look at this.
We're not doing our budget.
Well, again, we can't do a budget because we don't have, I don't know what to put in there.
Right name.
For what?
Code enforcement officer.
We have an amount of code enforcement right now.
We have a line item for a code enforcement officer.
We could use a lot, utilize about $30,000 of that for something else.
$30,000 something.
Right now, the salary is already sitting there to be applied towards that, so it's being used towards it. There we have that salary, the money retires out. You know, you have that in the benefits, it's come back in your budget, it's gonna go towards that.
What do you mean salaries?
His salary, Bob's salary, you're gonna be talking.
He's done after G7.
She's talking about what he's gonna put in next year's budget.
Well, that's why we could have voted on something, like to put less money in there.
Right.
Because Bob over the years was able to bring in different revenues now. That, he lost the assistant, in that scenario, that isn't including the borough manager, assistant.
All due respect, when we decided to put a full-time manager in and put the price out there, was we all agreed that we weren't going to need the part-time, and then it never happened as far as pulling that back. So you're now paying $120,000 a year for your management altogether, because that stayed in the budget, so. council said when we did the hiring, and say we're paying 80 and keeping 20 for an assistant, we paid 100 and got the assistant on after.
Just wanted to let you see what the costs were. Actually, I have the.
The agenda for tonight, or for next Monday?
You have a breakdown of the.
We vote for an adjournment.
Once you said you got an answer.
Did we vote for an adjournment?
No, not yet.
Oh.
I wasn't sure if I just adjourned.
So we keeping 9A on there, or are we taking it off?
Leave it in the table.
Leave it on the table?
That'll be pulled off the table?
Doesn't have to be.
But I mean, that's what would happen.
If you take it off the table, then you have to vote on it. If you just leave it there, you make up your mind, and you can pull it off the table in December if you.
Dave's note here says it must be placed on the agenda of this meeting for consideration to remove it from the table and discuss. So it's gotta be on there, but it's up to us to pull it back. So it's, I would say it's still on the agenda.
Yeah.
As a table item.
Right.
And then you can vote to leave it on the table.
Just say what's good table.
Leave it.
Yeah, you can leave it on.
That's my opinion, I'm not gonna be here, I don't think you should act on it, I'm just too much consensus.
Just like baseball.
Where are you going?
I mean.
November?
Are you going to Wayne's? So, may I have a motion to adjourn this meeting?
Don't move.
Say it.
And Corinne, any questions or comments, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Seven to zero.
What'd you say?
No, no, no.
I'm borrowing. My son is treating.
Your son treats you always well.
He's a star.